Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gently, Jolene, by Angela Scipioni. Narrated by Nicol Zanzarella. 1. There was something about the man in the cockpit that gave Jolene the jitters. She was particularly sensitive when it came to pilots, and by the time Comandante Adalberto Giacomini finished his welcome aboard spiel, she couldn't shake the feeling that he must be overworked or ill, maybe even drunk or doped up on painkillers. The Transitalia flight had been airbound for close to an hour now, every minute of which she'd spent sitting as far at the edge of her seat as her securely fastened seatbelt would allow, her buttocks clenching each time a ding or a dong sounded in the cabin. Not everyone was aware that the chimes were used to compose more complex messages than return to your seat or fasten your seatbelt. But Jolene knew that those two tones were the building blocks of a secret language employed by the pilot and his crew to warn one another of all kinds of dangers they wanted to hide from the passengers. Each airline company devised its own code, and Jolene was still trying to crack the one being used aboard her first Italian flight when another duplet of dings made her spine stiffen and her left eye twitch. "Here's the story, signore and signori," sang the captain, tossing Italian in with the English like dressing on a salad. "We're in for a bumpy landing, so no more standing." After allowing himself a moment to chuckle at his little rhyme, he cleared his voice and spoke again. "So be good, fate I bravi, and buckle up while we weather the winds. One way or another, we should be on the ground in Genoa in about 15 minutes, if not sooner." One way or another? If not sooner? What kind of a pilot would say things like that? Fear triggered anger in Jolene, and nothing frightened her more than feeling helpless. She saw herself storming the cockpit, jabbing a finger in the pilot's face, and reminding him that his job was not only to land the plane safely, but to keep his passengers calm and comfortable while doing so. She knew that attempting such an action would only get her in trouble, though, since the door would be locked and she would be restrained, her wrists bound in zip-tie cuffs or seatbelt extensions. She tried not to think about her father when speculating about what kind of man was at the controls, but it was always his puffy face she envisioned beneath the brim of the pilot's cap. It was always his bloodshot eyes she glimpsed peering at her from behind the tinted lenses of the Ray-Bans perched on his bulbous nose. And it was always his voice she heard, berating her for her fears, saying it was a slap in the face to him, because it was always about him, that the daughter of a pilot hated to fly. In this case, he was right. It was about him, because her lack of trust in him as a father, at home, extended to him as a pilot in his plane, and by association to all pilots flying all planes in all skies all across the globe. Even after her father was stripped of his wings and could no longer pose a threat to her or the unsuspecting passengers he held hostage, the seeds of anxiety he had planted in Jolene by forcing her to fly against her will took root and grew in the fertile soil of a girl's mind, writhing with the worms of insecurity, blossoming into a full-fledged phobia by her teenage years. As an adult, her way of dealing with the fear was quite simple. She did not fly. But when taking to the skies was unavoidable, she refused to swallow pills that would lull her into a false sense of security at a time when she most needed to be alert. She had devised other ways of dealing with her anxiety until boarding, marching incessantly through the terminal to keep her body busy while occupying her mind with speculations about the people around her, trying to guess who they were, where they were going, and why. Not one to bolt at the last minute, she always managed to get herself aboard and strapped into her seat, her eyes darting as she evaluated the flight crew, located the emergency exits, and scanned the faces of the other passengers. As the aircraft taxied into position for takeoff, and the placidly purring engines were throttled to a diabolic whir, the physical symptoms set in. The dry mouth, the pasty tongue, the sweaty palms, the hammering heart, the spasms of the minuscule muscle at the outside corner of her left eye. During this stage, her sense of impending disaster was exacerbated by the criminal distraction of those seated around her, who were more interested in munching on snacks and settling in for some mindless entertainment than watching the safety demonstrations. Their extreme nonchalance alarmed her, and they didn't seem to realize that it was for their own good when she quizzed them on emergency landing procedures and the proper use of oxygen masks. Some replied with a suspicious stare, others with a nervous giggle, possibly taking her for a lunatic or amateur terrorist, maybe even an undercover investigator from the NTSB. By the time the plane reached cruising altitude, it was not unusual for her to have already interrogated her neighbors regarding their previous experiences with the airline company and its pilots. The fact that no one ever remembered the name of any pilot, not even the one who had introduced himself just minutes earlier, the very same one upon whom their survival depended, always astonished her. But maybe people didn't want to know. Maybe it was easier to trust someone with your life when they remained anonymous, and therefore devoid of human qualities. If people realized that the guy in charge was one of them, they might start worrying about whether he'd gotten a good night's sleep, or eaten a nourishing breakfast, or tipped a glass too many the night before. Or whether he was a right-winger or a left-winger, a child-beater or a wife-cheater, a religious fanatic or non-believer, a gambler or a meanie. Which brought her back to her father, the pilot. George W. Twyman, that was his name. Instead of letting people assume that the W stood for Washington, he made it a point to state his name in full whenever he drawled his own introduction.
Captain George Wallace Twyman.
A name that was impossible to forget. A name that still had the power to make Jolene cringe. But that was then. It was over, in the past. The last leg of this long trip was almost over, too, thanks be to God. Anyone could remember his name. And he was the one who was in charge anyway, not that lunatic Commandante Giacomini. That was what Jolene kept telling herself as she sat strapped in her seat, her eyes squeezed tight as the plane bucked and bounced its way to the ground. When she finally summoned the courage to peek out her porthole, she was horrified to see nothing but jagged mountains and white-capped waters rotating in a nauseating fashion as the plane banked, and no sign of a suitable place to land. The fuselage trembled, slapped by the gusts rushing down the valleys of the Ligurian Apennines to ram the crosswinds blowing ashore from the Mediterranean, pushing and shoving the aircraft like bullies from rival gangs, before letting it drop on a runway which, miraculously, had materialized beneath them.
"Welcome to Genoa,"
Filippo said, leaning close to be heard above the whining of the plane reversing its engines and roaring to a halt, just as Jolene thought it would skid off the runway and belly flop into the sea. She was grateful that Filippo had been so engrossed in his complimentary copy of Il Corriere della Sera after months of deprivation that he hadn't noticed how petrified she'd been after doing so well on the overnight transatlantic flight from New York to Rome. Not wanting to spoil their trip in any way, Jolene had decided to keep her fear of flying to herself. But words were superfluous with a man as sensitive and understanding as Filippo. Back at JFK, when he'd noticed her sitting with her eyes closed, breathing through her nose, like she'd learned years ago in the pranayama exercises of her yoga class, Filippo didn't tease her or ply her with stupid statistics about planes being safer than cars. Instead, he'd told her that it was her right to be afraid. That just because millions of people each day paid to get locked up with a bunch of strangers inside a giant metal tube shooting through the troposphere to the stratosphere, then being dumped at far-flung destinations, didn't mean that it was normal. He'd walked with her and talked with her as they waited to board. He'd loosened her up with an outrageously expensive martini and entertained her with stories of his childhood in the Cinque Terre. Once on the plane, he'd made sure she was as comfortable and relaxed as possible, Then he'd put his background as a hotelier to good use, pretending to be her personal waiter during dinner, extolling the qualities of each menu option, recommending wines, making sure her glass was never empty, until she'd become drowsy. Afterward, he'd tucked a blanket around her legs and stuck pods in her ears, explaining that she'd soon fall under the spell of the hypnotic piano music of Maestro Einaudi, Filippo's favorite Italian composer. Then Jolene had dozed off, exactly as Filippo had said she would, waking just before landing in Rome, convinced that she'd been cured of her fear of flying for good.
"Are you with me, splendore mio?"
Filippo asked, tapping her on the head with his rolled-up newspaper. The gesture was playful, even affectionate, but the presence of strangers made Jolene's cheeks flush with humiliation. It was no fault of Filippo's, but the gesture reminded her of the way her father used to discipline the family dog. And sometimes Jolene herself, back in the days when newspapers were thick and inky and delivered to their doorstep each morning.
"How stupid can you be?" was what her father, the captain, always yelled when wielding his paper club, making both Jolene and the dog cower, regardless of which one he intended to clobber.
But this was not her father, she reminded herself. This was a man who did not call her stupid, but my splendor. And he called her that in Italian.
"Welcome to Genoa," I said,
Filippo repeated, prying Jolene's fingers from the armrest and clasping her hands in his. He raised them to his lips, engaging her gaze with eyes so dark and round they made her think of two brimming cups of espresso, with which she hoped to revive herself soon. His whiskers grazed the back of one hand, then the other as he kissed them, leaving warm, tingly tracks on her skin. Although she didn't want it to, because she did not want to be reminded of anything else that had come before this precious moment, this time Filippo's gesture made her think of the last guy who had tried to impress her by kissing her hand. In that unfortunate instance, her skin had burned even more due to a glob of extra-hot barbecue sauce ferried there via the guy's greedy mouth, which until a second before had been chomping on buffalo chicken wings. She could still hear the pig laughing when she thought about it now. She could still feel his greasy tongue licking off the oily orange splotch with a grunt. Shaking the memory from her head, she instinctively wiped the backs of her hands on her jeans.
"Are you feeling okay, splendore?"
Filippo asked when she still did not speak, his brow furrowing that way it did when he worried. Filippo's forehead was one of his most expressive features, the place where his strongest emotions were played out, leading Jolene to suspect that his receding hairline was a direct result of his forehead's determination to claim a larger stage for itself. Whether rippling with fleeting concern or creased with deeper troubles, each telltale line was underscored by the thick black brows, which stretched out over his eyes when in repose, but shot up to form twin arches when provoked.
"Yes, now I'm fine," Jolene said, sure that she would be in just a few minutes.
After gathering their belongings, Jolene and Filippo inched their way to the exit of the cramped aircraft, jostled by the elbows and shoulders and cumbersome carry-ons of the other passengers. Finally reaching the door, Jolene paused to breathe in the fresh wind, feeling so giddy with relief that her legs wobbled, forcing her to grab the handrail as she descended the stairs. The feel of her feet hitting the ground fortified her. The sound of her rubber soles squeaking on the tarmac reassured her, confirming that she was no longer a powerless pebble of a person being catapulted through the air. She blinked several times, her green eyes gritty and shocked by the morning light glinting off every surface around her. Slabs of granite, panes of glass, panels of metal, stretches of asphalt, and beyond it all, the shimmering blue body of water. Squinting against the sun and wind as her loose hair whipped her face, Jolene shrugged her backpack from her shoulder and fished out her sunglasses. Settling them on her nose, she surveyed her surroundings.
"It's that way, right?" she asked, pointing across the gulf toward a humpbacked mountain jutting into the sea, bathed in the golden September sun climbing in a cloudless sky. Clearly, that direction was east, which meant she could find north, which meant she could find anything. While growing up, Jolene had been constantly prodded by her mother to establish her bearings so that she would always know how to get where she was going and how to return to where she had come from. Whether they were out rowing on the lake or cruising the aisles of a supermarket, her mother would only give her directions in terms of east or west, north or south, never referring to right and left like normal people did. Right and left are relative to a person's position, making them subject to misinterpretation, her mother never tired of repeating. The cardinal points are absolute. Always pursue the absolute, Jolene. That's right, Filippo said, taking her chin in his hand and her mind off the past. That's the promontory of Portofino, and beyond that, well, you'll soon see for yourself, won't you? Overwhelmed by the importance of this moment, Jolene paused to contemplate the view and her future in silence. She'd learned enough to know that they would be following the Ligurian coast southeast toward Tuscany. The map in her backpack was already worn, its creases tearing, its colors smudging, as if she had been wandering around the country for weeks on foot instead of in her head. Sure, she had done a bit of online research too, but physical maps were more inspiring, more reliable. You could carry a map in your pocket. You could spread it open and run your fingers over its roads and highways, mountains and lakes, cities and countrysides, while your imagination roamed around all those new places, met new people, grabbed new opportunities, explored less traveled routes. Fantasizing about the future had always helped Jolene push back memories of the past, embrace her present, and cultivate hope for brighter days. She had been doing a lot of that lately, ever since one fine June evening on Cayuga Lake, before she even owned a map of Italy. The group she'd been responsible for welcoming aboard the tour boat were attendees of a postgraduate summer session program in hospitality management at Cornell University. And as part of their orientation, they were to be treated to a sunset cruise. Jolene's job was to smile and serve the wine, and although she did not make a habit of flirting while on duty, or ever, she was flattered when the smartly dressed man who looked like he'd stepped out of a GQ ad in his navy deck shoes, yachting trousers, and brass-buttoned blazer smiled back and thanked her as graciously as if she were the owner of the boat rather than hired help. By his second glass of Glenora Riesling, the tall Italian was hovering at her elbow, cramping her pouring style as she served other guests, intent on striking up a conversation despite the constant interruptions. His English was passable, although a bit quirky, his accent charming, his knowledge of wine growing in the Finger Lakes region impressive. Before disembarking, he had handed her an embossed calling card on which his name alone, Filippo Garaventi, announced itself in boldface letters. When the man asked for her name and number, she surprised herself not only by complying, but watching to make sure that he got the spelling and number right as he jotted them down in the leather address book he slipped from his breast pocket. In the days that followed, this debonair Italian did something that no other man had ever done. He outran her fantasies. He phoned before she convinced herself that he'd crossed out her number. He invited her to dinner before she imagined meeting him for coffee. He kissed her over their entrees before she wondered whether his whiskers would feel scratchy. He told her he was in love with her before they made love. Though profoundly disappointed by her failed marriage to Danny in her younger years and severely shaken by her disastrous breakup with Evan, Jolene remained a romantic. Sure, it hadn't been easy lately, when the only men she met were so wishy-washy and confused and selfish and petrified of rejection that they wouldn't even use the word relationship when referring to ongoing interactions with a woman. But Filippo Garaventi was not that kind of man. He was a man who talked, but not only about himself. He charged through whatever language barriers tried to stop him from expressing his ideas and opinions, picking up the conversation initiated that day on the boat, and carrying it on day after day with ease and enthusiasm. He led their discourse through a wide range of subjects, from the philosophy and techniques behind biodynamic winemaking, to the success of Italy's slow food movement, to the upheaval in the American political scene, to Brexit and its repercussions on the European Union, to why Jolene absolutely must not miss the Caravaggio exhibition at Milan's Palazzo Reale. Intrigued by his views, starved for stimulating talk, and eager to practice the Italian she'd learned years ago, Jolene was a keen listener. Up until now, she'd been convinced that she preferred quiet men. But she suspected that was only because she'd never met one with anything original to say. Filippo, with his international education and continental culture, held her spellbound. Between his conversational skills, his impeccable manners, and his unabashed interest in her, the hours and days and weeks she spent in his company passed as in a dream. If anyone were to ask her how long they had been together, she would have been shocked to realize that almost 4 months had gone by since that day on the boat, and even more astonished that it hadn't been longer. Such a perfect balance of passion and clear-headedness, romanticism and practicality, chivalry and hot pursuit had set her smoldering hopes and flickering fantasies aflame. She'd felt herself drifting effortlessly toward a future together, as if she were floating gently down the stream in her mother's old rowboat. And now she was here, her 2 feet firmly planted on foreign soil, as the other passengers hurried toward the bus that would shuttle them to the terminal, while she stood looking off into the horizon, immobilized by the realization that the future she had been imagining was no longer a romantic's dream. It was here and now, swirling all around her, blotting out the past. She was incredibly excited, justifiably nervous, and more than a little scared. Her insides were all in a tangle, like the mass of rubber bands she had been surprised to discover inside a golf ball her father had once cracked open in a fit of rage. "Breathe, Jolene," she reminded herself as she recited her litany of logic. She was here because she and Filippo were in love, because Filippo was right when he said that at their age, she 38 and he 34, they were both old enough to know what they wanted in a partner. And because he was right about them being a perfect team from a professional point of view. Between their combined studies and experience in food service and hospitality, they could accomplish marvelous things at Locanda Luisa, the hotel in the Cinque Terre that Filippo's family had been running in the same backward way for the past half century. What was a woman supposed to do when a handsome, sensitive, well-educated Italian man sauntered into her life, laid claim to her heart, offered her a dream job in one of the most spectacular destinations in the world, and proposed marriage on top of it all? Jolene couldn't help wondering whether her mother would have supported her decision or discouraged her. She, too, had moved to a new city for love, then given up her career as a flight attendant when she became pregnant with Jolene. It was unfortunate that her mother's unerring sense of direction failed to make her steer clear of the captain, but the compass that could deter women from the treacherous course of love had not yet been invented. Jolene's situation was different, though. Filippo had earned her trust, and by his side, she would discover a new world, become acquainted with its people, adopt its customs, master its tongue. She even had a head start on the language, thanks to her high school pal Anna Vigevani, a native of Brescia. Fascinated by the banter of Anna's foreign family, Jolene had striven to understand what they said to one another, a longing that induced her to drop French and take up Italian. Lately, she had been wondering where Anna might be now. But her curiosity was of the vague sort, never compelling enough to make her conduct a search. Maybe she preferred to remember Anna as an exotic 16-year-old, just like she herself would rather be remembered as the dewy-eyed daydreamer who hung around their house, her tongue struggling to pronounce the Italian expressions they taught her, her tummy craving the Italian food they fed her, her heart yearning for the Italian affection they bestowed upon her. "Ow!" Jolene cried out as a pain shot down her elbow to her forearm, making Anna and her parents and the entire city of Chicago retreat to the past.
"What are you doing, Splendore? I thought you were right behind me, and when I turned around, I saw you were just standing there, lost in your own little world. What on earth are you thinking about now?"
Though he had her attention, Filippo pressed his thumb into her elbow joint a second time.
"Stop that," Jolene cried, shaking the jolt from her arm. "You promised that my funny bone would be off limits."
"And you promised that you would always tell me what's on your mind."
He often commented that she had a faraway look in her eyes and asked her what she was thinking. And while his curiosity sometimes seemed genuine, at other times she perceived a hint of irritation that tautened the tone of his voice like a tuning peg, adding an edge of sharpness. Or, in extreme cases, prompted his famous funny bone squeeze.
"Well," he said, ushering her toward the crowded bus, "are you going to tell me or not?"
Jolene stumbled after him, knowing she would not be able to weave together the tendrils of her thoughts, much less bundle them up into a concise answer of the sort Filippo preferred to hear. By now, she knew that if they were in a restaurant, for example, it would be better to say that she was debating over what to order, rather than admit to dwelling on some uninvited, random thought that had pulled up a chair at their table and sat down next to her. He was right, of course. She should learn to take control of her mind and focus on who she was with and what she was doing. But keeping the intruders out was no easy feat. Besides, regardless of whether or not he was really interested in her meandering thoughts, sometimes she just did not want to answer. Not to hide things from him, but to keep them to herself, which was different. So many of her nagging notions and resurfacing memories were no more than toxic exhalations from the landfill of her past, and she was determined to keep them buried where they belonged. Thousands of miles away, where they could not pollute her new life.
"Nothing, really," she mumbled, stepping aboard the shuttle as the doors nipped at her ankle.
Grabbing a pole for support as the bus lurched forward, she glanced at Filippo and was dismayed to notice his lips pursing in that way that made it seem they were being held hostage by the neatly trimmed mustache and equally well-groomed beard that surrounded them. She had seen that look on other occasions, when Filippo was irritated with someone but restrained himself, being too classy to swear, too well-mannered to shout. She had never been responsible for provoking that look before. At least she didn't think so. But she was still learning so much about him. It would take a little time for her to interpret his subtler forms of expression, like the various ways he raised his eyebrows or rolled his eyes. But now that they would be living together, everything would be easier to figure out. The bus jerked to a halt, the opening doors hissing their dismissal. Jolene followed Filippo down the steps and into the sleepy terminal, where a lone red suitcase circled dejectedly around the only baggage claim belt in operation, as if planted there to hypnotize impatient travelers forced to endure a long wait. Jolene, too, began staring at the red suitcase going round and round, her bleary eyes struggling to stay focused, her lids growing heavier with each passage. She was startled when a procession of fresh bags began stumbling down the chute, and she recognized hers among them, thanks to the braids of green hair yarn she had tied to their handles, like her mother had taught her. Before she could make a move, Filippo grabbed the bags, springing to action like a parent dragging a straying child to safety before it could be snatched by a stranger. Gripping a suitcase in each hand, he turned to face her. His lips now spread in a proud grin, as if he himself were responsible for the miracle of their persons and possessions being reunited in the same spot. It gave Jolene a feeling of lightness, almost queasiness, to realize that all she had left in the world was right there, in this one man and those two bags. Donating all of her clothes to the Salvation Army hadn't been a premeditated gesture of goodwill, nor were her motives for doing so entirely noble. Tackling the daunting task of packing for her overseas move, she had scrutinized each article of clothing to decide whether it should be allowed to continue life with her. It perplexed her that some items seemed so heavy that her arms could hardly hold them up, before realizing that it was the memories attached to certain garments that weighed them down, not the materials of which they were made. They were stitched into the seams of the hiking pants she had worn while exploring the trails of Buttermilk Falls with Evan. They were entwined in the spaghetti straps of the black knit dress she had worn to the opening of their restaurant. They were balled up like tear-stained tissues and stuffed into the pockets of the faded cotton sundress she had worn on the first of many picnics one hot summer with Danny, the boy who had been her sweetheart for longer than he had remained her husband. She became so distracted by the emotions stirred up by every garment, so possessed with unraveling every thread of sadness, unzipping every tragedy, digging into every pocket of disappointment, examining every torn expectation and snagged plan, that the only way for her to get on with the job had been to eliminate every article connected with painful memories, which was pretty much everything. Everything except for a few special items she had wrapped with care and buried beneath the innocuous old clothes and memory-free new clothes that filled her suitcases. Still staring at Filippo and the bags, she was uplifted by this compact version of Jolene Twyman, already taking up less space in the world. Already soaring to new heights, now that she was finally free from the presences and absences that tethered her to an old identity, to an outdated past, to superseded sentiments.
"I've got everything, Splendore,"
Filippo said a moment later, hoisting the second of his own suitcases onto the pile in the cart and already pushing it toward the exit.
"Yes, you do," Jolene smiled, noticing as she followed him that one wheel of the cart twirled around in circles, making it hard for him to steer straight.
"And so do I." The wayward cartwheel wobbled as Filippo pushed their luggage toward the exit, calling unwanted attention to them as they approached customs. Jolene always got nervous when she was asked to show documents she was sure would be found irregular, or open luggage to display her personal belongings to strangers. Today, she was particularly apprehensive. Today, the rest of her life depended on being admitted to Italy with no glitches. When the uninterested officer stamped her passport and waved her through with a cursory glance, Jolene wiped her sweaty palms on her jeans and breathed a sigh of relief. Stepping lightly, she trotted alongside Filippo and the defective cart, noticing that he did not seem to mind the extra work required to keep it on a straight path, as if even this were an opportunity to prove that nothing could slow him down when he had a plan. Thankfully, the terminal at Cristoforo Colombo Airport was small, and they were soon outside.
"Giobata!"
Filippo cried, consigning the cart to Jolene's custody as he waved, striding toward a wiry, white-haired man in a beret standing next to a little green car parked at the curb. Jolene watched the two men shake hands, brush cheeks, and embrace. Having been born in these parts, Filippo Gadaventi had many people to come home to, and Jolene was looking forward to finally meeting them all. Save for a few photos of himself as a child, Filippo hadn't shown her any of the images she'd often glimpsed him swiping at on the screen of his phone. The reasoning behind this was that he wanted her to have a fresh impression of the people she would meet, and although she appreciated the concept, not knowing what anyone looked like gave her one more thing to be nervous about. It would have been reassuring to be able to recognize a person or two in Manarola, a town with almost 400 unfamiliar faces, in a country with over 60 million unfamiliar faces. It was an uneasy feeling for someone who didn't even like going to parties where she didn't know anyone, unless it was a catering job and she was expected to work, not mingle. The thought made her mull over the fact that working a party was actually more enjoyable than attending a party, which made her reflect on parties in general. She was racking her brain, trying to remember one party to which she'd been invited in the past 5 years and had a good time, when something caught her eye. Filippo was waving both arms in the air, calling her over. She gave the lame wheel a kick and pushed the cart to the car, where the first new face to which she could attach a name awaited her.
"Jolene, I want you to meet Ciabatta," Filippo said.
"Piacere, Ciabatta,"
Jolene said, smiling as she shook the man's hand while thinking it odd that he should be named after a type of bread, which in turn took its name from the flat slipper it resembled. Ciabatta nodded, touched a finger to his beret, and relieved her of the luggage cart.
"It's not Ciabatta, cara Jo. It's Ciabatta," Filippo said, standing with her at the curb while the man loaded the car. "Short for Giovanni Battista. John the Baptist was a popular saint around here, so lots of older people were named after him. It's a little outdated now, but don't tell him that."
Peering down at her from his 6-inch advantage, Filippo gave her a pat on the head, making her feel small in a way she was unaccustomed to. Though he was taller, Jolene was older, and up until today, she had been the one introducing him to new people, showing him new places, telling him how things worked, correcting his pronunciation. Up until today, they'd been playing on her home turf, but now the roles would be reversed. It would be a relief to let Filippo take charge while she settled in, she told herself, to let him do the explaining while she looked on, listened, and learned. Not one for dilly-dallying, Ciabatta had already stowed the luggage in the boxy Fiat Panda, managing, through a combination of Italian design, creative thinking, and a good deal of pushing and shoving, to make everything fit without Filippo's help. When Ciabatta slid behind the wheel, Filippo insisted Jolene sit in the front seat while he straddled a suitcase in the back, joking that there was nothing he enjoyed more than riding with his knees in his ears. Between the bridges and tunnels, followed by more bridges and tunnels of the trafficked A12 highway, Jolene glimpsed the urban sprawl of Genoa, trapped between the Mediterranean Sea to her right, southish, and the steep Ligurian hillside to her left, north-ish. Once past the city, a succession of towns flashed by in a blur of oranges and greens, pinks and ochres, prompting Jolene to pair them with the names she recalled from her map and now spotted on the exit signs. Nervi, Recco, Rapallo, Chiavari. Smaller clusters of buildings gripped the mountainside, as if fearful of sliding down into the sea, while others huddled around coastal coves, as if jealously guarding sunken treasures. In the first hour of the two it took Ciabatta to drive the couple to their destination, Jolene learned that the man was neither an uncle nor an older cousin of Filippo's, but the only driver in Manarola the Garaventi family trusted. Despite her waning alertness and Ciabatta's frequent lapses into local dialect, she managed to follow the conversation well enough to learn that this family friend was so reliable that he had been the one to rush Filippo's mother, Luisa, to the hospital in La Spezia when she gave birth to Filippo. Everyone who had anything to say on the subject, meaning, Filippo paused to point out to her, virtually everyone in town, concurred that it would have been impossible for Vittorio, Filippo's father, to accompany the laboring woman himself when the locanda was crowded with hungry guests waiting to be served the day's special of freshly caught anchovies, whose silvery little bodies he had painstakingly decapitated, split open, deboned, coated with flour, and had been dipping one by one into a skillet of sizzling olive oil when Filippo's mother's water broke all over the kitchen floor. However, if those same villagers were to be believed, the locanda was, on the contrary, deserted on the morning Mama Luisa and her infant were pronounced fit and ready to go home. The only baker in town had no doubt as to the veracity of this, remembering distinctly that no orders had been placed for focaccia or rolls or bread of any sort, as Vittorio Garavente was so notoriously tight-fisted, even for a Ligurian, that he ate stale bread when he had no guests to feed, expecting his family to do the same. The owner of the tobacco shop newsstand agreed that it must have been so, because the only paper requested by little Lorenzo, Luisa's firstborn, who ran the morning errands, was the usual house copy of Liguria's daily, Il Secolo Diciannovesimo, which each morning was clamped to a wooden rack and placed at the disposal of the regulars who stopped by the Locanda for a chat and a coffee or a nip of white wine. Had there been any lodgers, Vittorio would have been forced to invest in a variety of papers, since even back then, anyone who took a room at Locanda Luisa would surely demand a copy of Milan's Corriere della Sera, or one of those other big city papers, to read over their morning cappuccino and brioche. In reality, it was explained, Signor Garavente's reluctance to drive to La Spezia to pick up Luisa and the still nameless baby stemmed from the fact that the man would have nothing to do with cars. The motives of his aversion went beyond that of avarice, though the ownership of an automobile would doubtless entail a great deal of expense, between the purchase and fuel and upkeep and insurance and annual registration tax. Vittorio Garavente so detested the sight of those four-wheeled intruders that crept over the hills and descended on the village, hogging up the precious space between the banks of the Rio Groppo and the steep hillside, that he refused to ride in them. He predicted that their numbers would grow, which would lead to the widening of roads and the gutting of mountains and the paving of parking lots, causing more crowding, more noise, more pollution. Cars could do nothing for nature but destroy it, and nothing for him but disrupt the quiet life he had known since his birth in the isolated fishing village of Manarola. According to Filippo, his father, being a man who refused to adapt his needs to anyone else's schedule, disdained trains too. As a business owner, however, he admitted that the Ferrovie dello Stato played a precious role in bringing in the tourists and their money, an invasion he tolerated as long as he was not denied his inalienable right as a Ligurian to complain about it. In short, as far as Filippo's father was concerned, any man worth his weight in sea salt needed only one other means to get around in the Cinque Terre, besides a set of good, strong limbs, his boat. That may well be, except when you have a newborn baby to pick up from the hospital, conceded Giobatta, who then went on to rehash the argument he'd had with Vittorio on the matter. In the end, it had been Giobatta, exasperated by his friend's pigheadedness, who hopped in the car and drove to the hospital. After which, Vittorio did not speak to Giobatta until the day of Filippo's baptism, when he began circulating the story of being stuck in the kitchen with the Locanda full of guests, which everyone pretended to believe, while knowing it was not true. "Let's give it a rest for now," Filippo said when Giobatta paused to let the facts sink in. "I don't want Jolene to get any wrong ideas before she even meets anyone." Giobatta said nothing more, but judging by the way his Adam's apple bobbed when he swallowed his words, Jolene sensed he was disappointed at being silenced. He concentrated on driving now, his bony fingers gripping the steering wheel, his sharp gray eyes flickering as they blinked away the past and focused on the road ahead. Filippo sighed and leaned back in his seat, whether tired of old tales, weary of his awkward position, or sick of hearing that his father thought his obligation to anchovies more important than attending his birth, it was hard to say. Jolene would have liked to hear more anecdotes about the family, but deferred to Filippo's wishes, knowing that the stories would be more meaningful and easier to follow once she met the cast of characters. Besides, once Giobatta exited the fast-paced autostrada and swerved onto the winding road that led from La Spezia, up through the hills and into the heart of the Cinque Terre, the scenery unfurling before her was so spectacular that she wouldn't have been able to speak or listen. No story about people she did not yet know could captivate her attention like the astonishing views filling her eyes with beauty and her soul with joy. Motoring amid the sun-drenched hillsides spattered with silvery olive trees, she marveled at the dry stone walls snaking across the terraced strips of land strung with gold-leafed grapevines. She gasped at the dramatic vistas of the indigo sea that crashed against the rocks far below, sucking in her breath at every hairpin turn Jobata navigated by constantly upshifting and downshifting with the assurance of a rally driver, all the way to their final descent to Manarola. It wasn't until he coasted into a parking spot and pulled the handbrake, jerking the exhausted panda to a halt, that Jolene realized she had lost all sense of direction. 2.
Finalmente!
A woman's voice rang out over the drum roll of trolleys trailing the trio comprised of Jolene, Filippo, and Jobata as they walked from the residence parking area to the center of Manarola. Save for rare exceptions, Filippo was explaining, the road running through the village was off limits to motor vehicles, but that didn't really matter since the only place it took you was straight into the sea. Jolene had one ear tuned into what he was saying, while the other was bent on discovering where that voice had come from.
Arrivo, subito!
The voice sang again, allowing Jolene to trace it to a lady waving from the third floor of a faded pink building. In the time it took Jolene to blink, the woman disappeared, leaving in her place a lace curtain fluttering in an empty window, flanked by a pair of green shutters. Before she could ask Filippo whether he knew this woman, she reappeared on the road, wearing a plain white blouse tucked into a knee-length blue skirt. Her attire reminded Jolene of the garb worn by the more modern nuns she had sometimes seen in church during her years as a Catholic.
Mamma, Filippo cried when he saw her.
Splendore mio!
It struck Jolene as odd that Filippo would greet his mother with the same term of endearment he used with her, but she didn't have time to decide whether it bothered her. It was all she could do to keep up with Filippo as he dragged her by the hand toward the woman.
I hardly recognized you with your new hairdo, he said, dropping Jolene's hand to hug and kiss his mother. This color is fabulous on you.
Oh, well, I don't know about that,
the woman said, looking embarrassed, either at the compliment or at the revelation that chestnut brown was not her natural color, while patting her helmet of lacquered hair as if she were still getting to know it, or perhaps feared breaking it.
The village ladies ganged up on me. They said I should look presentable for my son's homecoming. It made me wonder how they normally see me.
Thanks to Filippo's refusal to share descriptions or photos with her, Jolene couldn't know what the woman had looked like before the hairdresser's intervention, but she had been picturing a stone-faced signora dressed in black from head to toe, her gray locks coiled under a hairnet like a snake, ready to lash out at anyone who dared to hijack her son's affection or jeopardize his well-being. The woman before her seemed more dynamic than she'd imagined. The style and shade of her hair were typical of older ladies who got their hair done once a week and didn't like it to be mussed between appointments. Though relieved that the woman did not resemble the Italian mother-in-law of her nightmares, Jolene had to scramble to rethink her approach. Filippo had told her to just be yourself and everyone will love you as much as I do. But she didn't even know what that meant anymore. Together with most of her possessions, she had left all the roles that defined that self back in America, making her wonder how Signora Garaventi would perceive her, who she had been expecting, and who she would see. She detested feeling so nervous and unsure of herself at this age and stage of her life. Hadn't she already been inoculated against the ordeal of parental inspection a couple of decades earlier? The first time Danny brought her home for Thanksgiving dinner, arriving when the Doherty men were already so tipsy on highballs and engrossed in some football game that they barely looked up when Danny sprung the news that they would be married before the Rose Bowl. and again 5 years later when she had already been divorced for two, when Evan's parents stopped in for an impromptu visit en route from Schenectady to Niagara Falls to admire their son's new restaurant and caught Jolene on her hands and knees scrubbing the floors? You would think that by now she would be past worrying about what a grown man's parents thought of her. You would think that by now, after trying so hard to be accepted into the inner circle of the families she'd joined, only to suffer like an abandoned puppy when she was kicked back out into the cold, she'd toughen up a bit. Yet here she was again, with sweaty palms and a quivering smile, hoping she didn't look as haggard as she felt. For the moment, though, Signora Garaventi was still completely taken with Filippo, holding him at arm's length for her maternal inspection. "Are you trying to grow a beard?" she asked, pointing at the black bristles littering his chin. "This is a beard," Filippo said, stroking his jaw. "This is how they're worn now, ma." "It looks a little, I don't know, frustrated?" Jolene was pleased that she could follow the exchange in Italian without much difficulty. Despite her nervousness, or perhaps because of it, a giggle escaped her, but she masked the sound with a cough. Jolene herself was of the opinion that there were only two possible advantages to growing a beard: to keep one's face warm in a cold climate, or to elude the slavery of having to shave every day. Filippo's fuzz was too short to provide any insulation, and its upkeep seemed to require constant care. Instead of shaving once a day, Filippo fussed over his facial hair continually, trimming and clipping it each morning, performing on-the-spot touch-ups with the miniature barber's shears he carried in the breast pocket of his blazer whenever he noticed a whisker out of place. "I can't exactly afford to look like a hipster or a terrorist," Filippo said, "or a swami, if you can relate to that better. Don't forget, I am a hotel manager." "How could I ever forget that? You were born a hotel manager." His mother's eyes twinkled as they dropped from Filippo's face and came to rest on his midsection. She gave his tummy a little pat. "At least you've finally gained some weight." Jolene smiled to herself. She would never have had the nerve to do that. But she, too, had noticed a certain pudginess around his middle lately. His eagerness to explore the Finger Lakes food and wine trails far surpassed his enthusiasm for its hiking trails. 4 months of American food will do that to anyone," Filippo said. "But how about you? Have you lost weight? Have you been working too hard?" The lines on his forehead rippled with worry as he regarded his mother. "Well, you know, that's just the way it is toward the end of the season," she replied, waving away his concern as if it were a pesky fly. Then she turned her attention to her son's fiancé, her stare instantly deploying the ball of rubber bands wadded inside Jolene's stomach, where they ricocheted off the walls with an audible twang. Jolene was mortified, but either the woman wasn't close enough to hear the noise, or compassionate enough to pretend she didn't notice. She studied Jolene with eyes the color of a clear lake on a cloudy day, eyes that were neither friendly nor hostile, but as impartial as if they were examining a roadmap or a bus schedule. Then she approached her, extending her right hand. "I'm Filippo's mother," she said in English. She did not clasp Jolene's hand between hers, but shook it. Her grip was firm, her smile unguarded. She wore no lipstick or other makeup. "It's a pleasure to meet you," Jolene responded in English, partly out of respect for the woman's consideration in speaking her language, partly to dodge the problem of whether to use the familiar "to" form or the more formal "lei" when addressing her. She didn't know what local custom dictated when speaking to one's future mother-in-law. She didn't even know whether to call her Luisa or Signora Garaventi. Hoping for a cue, she added, "Io sono Jolene." "See, she even speaks Italian," Filippo said. "She's very smart." "Bene, molto bene," his mother said, scrutinizing Jolene's features. As she tended to do when embarrassed, Jolene smiled,
despite knowing that it would make her cheeks ball up, which would accentuate the wrinkles that had settled in around her eyes and mouth in the latter half of her 30s, with no apparent plans to go anywhere but deeper. The past 24 hours of travel hadn't exactly rejuvenated her aspect either.
"Finally, a grown woman," Filippo's mother said. "You can call me Luisa, va bene?"
"Va bene," Jolene said, nodding. "Thank you." With a few words in Italian and a few in English, she had survived the first and most important introduction while laying the cornerstones of her new identity. She was Jolene, a not-so-young American bride-to-be with a nervous stomach. Maybe that was all anyone needed to know for now.
"You look exhausted," Luisa said. "Why don't you show her to her room, Filippo? We can talk more after you've had some rest. I'll be where I always am, at the Locanda."
Jolene wanted to say that she'd love to see the Locanda first, but Luisa was already walking away. Minutes later, the color in Jolene's cheeks was high and bright as she looked over her shoulder at the path she and Filippo had already climbed. Some distance below them, Giobata emerged from between the colorful dwellings that towered over the narrow passage. With its uneven stone surfaces and stairs, this was not a town for trolleys. So instead of dragging Jolene's suitcase, he was forced to carry it, doing so with remarkable ease. Lean and lithe, Giobata seemed a younger man than suggested by his snowy white hair and leathery skin. But from what he'd said in the car, he must be around the same age as Filippo's father, who had recently turned 75. "I feel guilty having him lug my suitcase up here while all I'm carrying is my backpack," Jolene said. She wanted to ask why Filippo hadn't offered to carry it himself or help load the car at the airport, but she did not want to start questioning everything on the very first day. For the time being, it was best to just observe how things were done and try not to make any blunders. Look, listen, and learn, she reminded herself.
"Don't worry, he's used to manual labor,"
Filippo called over his shoulder as he trudged on, unfurling a linen handkerchief to dab the perspiration from his face and neck. He was fastidious about personal hygiene, and by now, Jolene knew that there were fewer things he found more distasteful than sweat, his as well as other people's.
"Are we almost there?" she asked, curious to see where he was leading her, wishing he would walk faster.
"Yep,"
Filippo replied, coming to a halt so abruptly that she crashed into him. Grinning, he pointed to a door that opened directly onto the footpath. Jolene stared at the weathered slab of rough wood, thrilled to be at its threshold, anxious to discover what lay behind it. Though old and splintered, to her it was the most beautiful door in the world. To her, it represented a new beginning.
"We'll get a new door, of course," Filippo said.
"No," Jolene cried. "We can restore this one."
Many of the doors she'd noticed on the walk up were new, all green and glossy with polished brass knobs. But this one was unique, and it would be a crime to replace it. In the center of the door was a rusty nail. From the nail dangled a chipped shingle of slate. Jolene leaned in close to read what remained of the hand-painted lettering. Locanda Luisa, Suite 16.
"This is it," Filippo said, "in all its glory."
"You didn't tell me we'd be staying in Suite 16. It reminds me of Suite 16, never been kissed, always been missed."
"What are you talking about?"
"Never mind," she said, smiling as she looked up at him. "I sometimes forget that you've never been a teenaged American girl. But it's a sign, Filippo. It's as if going through that door could take me back to when I was 16, all fresh and full of hope that the man of my dreams would one day come along and sweep me off my feet."
Filippo looked down at her, still looking puzzled and clueless that a kiss was called for. Not one to insist, Jolene turned her attention back to the shingle, holding her breath as she ran her index finger over the ridges of its cool, unpolished surface. Her new life with Filippo would begin right here, in Suite 16. Never again would she jolt awake in a sweat to find herself alone in her temporary apartment, her temporary job, her temporary life.
"That thing's filthy. Remember to wash your hands," Filippo said, taking a single key on a ring from his pocket, while Jolene regarded her smudged finger, appreciating the sight of a little local dirt after all the globe-trotting germs she must have been exposed to during the trip. She couldn't wait to shed her travel clothes and throw herself under the shower, then take a look at the other rooms, too. She had talked to Filippo at length about the family business, asking questions, tossing around ideas, and she was impatient to familiarize herself with the property. She could hardly believe she was being given the opportunity to work on such a stimulating project with the man she loved. They'd have such fun discussing the options, drawing up the projects, overseeing the renovations. She was itching to get started.
"So, where are the other 37 suites located?" she asked. There couldn't be more than a few in this small building.
15, Filippo muttered, jiggling the key in the lock.
"What?"
"There are 15 others," Filippo said. "Suite 16 was the last one to be added."
"I thought you said there were 38 suites in all."
"You must have misunderstood or been distracted. I said there were 38 beds in 16 suites. The Locanda started out with 4, right above the restaurant. But then the so-called suites were gradually added on, and those are all scattered around the village," Filippo said, his irritation with the stubborn lock creeping into his voice. He jiggled and turned the key, pushed and pulled the door, but it would not budge. Jolene prided herself on her memory for numbers, so she was pretty sure she hadn't misunderstood, though Filippo did sometimes manage to confuse her when he was trying to explain things, and admittedly, she was sometimes distracted when she was trying to listen. Whatever the case, there was a substantial difference between 16 guest rooms spread out in the village and a 38-room hotel. She wondered what sense it made for Filippo to attend an expensive post-grad course at Cornell to run such a modest operation, but then she reasoned that it was just another indication of how ambitious he was, of how no project was too big or too small for him. Like getting the door open, for example. It wasn't until he began ramming it with his shoulder that the wood finally gave way with a groan, and Filippo burst through, careening across the threshold. In the upset, the old slate shingle was ousted from its nail and sent crashing to the ground.
"Oh, no," Jolene said, bending to pick up the pieces. "What a shame."
"Honestly, Jolene, I could have broken my leg and you're worried about that old relic," Filippo said, though he was already standing in the middle of the room, brushing off his embarrassment at the awkward entrance with the same aplomb with which he flicked a dust ball from his shoulder. Then he adjusted his blue blazer, tugging at the hem and cuffs, assuring himself that the middle button was fastened. His composure regained, he made a sweeping gesture with his arm, his stance indicating that he was accustomed to showing grander suites to grander guests.
"Now then," he said, clearing his throat, "I hope you'll be comfortable in your temporary accommodations."
Though Jolene knew they wouldn't be staying in the Locanda indefinitely, Filippo's use of the word temporary made her left eye twitch. Peering into the dim room without entering, she waited to see whether he would come back to carry her over the threshold. It seemed like the kind of thing a romantic Italian man like him would do. Instead, he strode toward the window.
"Bastardo,"
Filippo grunted from the other side of the room, where he was wrestling with the window handle. It was strange to hear him curse for the first time, and in Italian. In a world rife with vulgarity, Filippo's clean language had been one of the qualities she'd first admired in him. In the months they'd been together, she had never even heard him throw in the odd shit or damn it in an effort to sound less foreign.
"Porca di una puttana maledetta," he cursed again.
The thin glass panes rattled at the insult, but the window succumbed and flew open.
A gust of wind snatched the shutters from Filippo's hands as soon as he unlatched them, slamming them against the facade of the building. The room was inundated with golden sunshine and a briny breeze. Shelving her threshold fantasy for when they would move into their permanent residence, Jolene dropped her backpack on the floor, stacking the slate shards beside it, and hurried to the window, marveling at the view of the shoulder-to-shoulder rooftops clustered below, of the grapevines stretched across the terraced land on the opposite side of the narrow valley, of the sun spilling its autumn glow over mountains and Mediterranean. It didn't matter that the view was partially blocked by the rooftops, or that the sea could only be glimpsed by leaning out the window. What mattered was that Jolene was in Italy, in the Cinque Terre, in Manarola, looking out the window of her room in Locanda Luisa, where she and Filippo would make their home and livelihood. Jolene cupped a hand over her dumbstruck mouth, tears of joy springing to her eyes.
"Well, aren't you going to say anything?" Filippo asked.
"It's just that this is all so amazing," Jolene whispered. "I can hardly believe it's real." Filippo put an arm around her shoulders as they stared out the window together. She let herself lean into him, relishing the reassurance she always felt when he locked her into that snug space under his arm.
"Well, it is real, and you'd better get used to it, splendore mio," he said, giving her a squeeze. "This is your room now, and the view is all yours."
Jolene gazed up at him. He looked more handsome than ever, with his face all awash in gold, his brown eyes shining with flecks of a rare amber.
"All ours, you mean?" "Well, I won't officially be staying here," he said, rewarding her upturned face with a peck on the lips. "This place is still a bit old-fashioned that way."
"Are you saying your mother wouldn't approve of us sleeping together? At our age?"
"No, it's not because of Mamma. It's everyone else. The Garaventis are an important family in these parts, you see. The villagers look up to us, but at the same time, they're envious, and they love to talk. We don't want to set their tongues barking."
"Wagging."
"What?"
"The expression. In English, you set tongues wagging, not barking."
"I was explaining something important to you, cara Jo," Filippo said.
He always insisted that she correct his English, but it always irritated him when she did. Now that they were in Italy, she thought it might be wise to switch to Italian so he could do the correcting. Unlike Filippo, she was used to screwing up all kinds of things. A disagreement between an article and subject or an improperly conjugated verb were mistakes she could live with.
"Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt," she said, "but I wasn't expecting to live on my own." "It's just for a while," Filippo said, pressing the tip of her nose with his index finger, as if it were a reset button used to dispel her disappointment. "We'll be married and living together before you know it. Trust me, I know what's best."
"I'm sure you do," Jolene said, readjusting her vision of the near future, another thing she was used to doing.
"Permesso," Giobata called from the open door, knocking on the jamb. "Come on in," Filippo said.
Giobata entered, deposited Jolene's suitcase on the floor, and turned to leave.
"Grazie,"
Jolene called after him, but he was gone before she could ask Filippo if it would be appropriate to tip him.
"This room is more habitable than the others, but as you may have noticed, it needs so much maintenance work that it makes more sense to demolish it," Filippo said.
"I'm not so sure about that," Jolene said. But as she looked around for something to praise, her eyes were drawn to the most unpleasant details, the way eyes tended to do, like when you were talking to a woman with a hairy mole on her face. Between the cracked ceiling and stained walls, the pea-green floor and cumbersome furniture, the faded photographs of dead fish hanging above the dresser, and the vase of fake flowers on the nightstand, it wasn't easy. But there were wood floors you could install right over the tiles, Clutter could be eliminated, and it wouldn't take much to plaster and paint everything white. I'm not saying it doesn't need work, but I can already picture how charming this room could be. Meanwhile, you'll have all the essentials for what I hope will be a comfortable stay. Filippo continued, ignoring her comment as he crossed the room. And an armadio for your clothes, he said, opening then slamming shut a clothes cupboard as if he had discovered the putrid corpse of a previous guest inside.
I'm afraid there's not a terrible amount of space.
It'll be fine, Jolene said, smiling. I don't have much.
Of course you have your own private bathroom, Filippo said, pushing open a rather ugly door that would need replacing, then flipping a switch.
A neon light flickered on, and off, and on.
Cazzo, you'd think they could at least learn how to change a light bulb.
Don't let these little things make you so upset, Filippo, Jolene said. Now that you're back, and I'm here with you, we'll make a list of all the jobs that require attention.
Yeah, well, it's the people doing the things, or rather not doing them, that upset me, he muttered, his hands at his sides, balled into fists.
Jolene wondered who he was referring to, but again deferred her questions. You're just tired from the trip, and so am I, she said. This is a special moment, and we shouldn't ruin it by focusing on anything negative. If she didn't complain about the shortcomings of the room, or harp on the fact that she would be staying there alone, he shouldn't either. Like you said, it's only temporary, right? And I can certainly change my own light bulbs.
Filippo sighed, relaxing his fists.
You're a gem, Jolene, he said. And you're right, you must be exhausted. The only thing I want you to worry about now is resting.
I was thinking we could freshen up and go for a stroll, she said.
A stroll? Now? What's the rush?
No rush, really, Jolene said, her voice cheerful, though she could already tell that the stroll wasn't going to happen. I was just looking forward to stretching my legs and having you show me around town. I need to get my bearings, and I can't wait to see where we'll be living and working together.
My legs got all the stretching they needed walking up here, Filippo said, shaking out the muscles of one leg, then the other, like he always did before and after a run. As for the town, you can practically see it all from the window.
Jolene returned to the window and leaned out. What's that place in front of us? She asked, pointing to the hillside across from them. Where I see those people walking.
That's Punta Bonfiglio, Filippo said, joining her.
There must be a gorgeous view of the sea from up there. And look at all those beautiful plants. It's hard to tell what they are from here, but I can see there are even some palm trees.
Yeah, people walk up there all the time to look at the view and sit in the garden, Filippo said. I'll take you there. Just not now, okay?
Sure. And how about that just next to it? She said, moving her fingers slightly while squinting into the distance. It looks like a gigantic beehive.
A beehive? Filippo said, laughing. That's the cemetery.
The cemetery? Oh.
So it's all above ground?
Most of it, except for a few old graves, Filippo said.
Where would you bury anyone here? There's hardly enough room for the living, let alone the dead.
So those empty holes are vacant slots? Do people reserve them in advance?
Honestly, Jolene, do you really have to fixate on the cemetery?
No, I was just curious, she said, her eyes already moving on, stopping when she spotted off to the right and a bit higher up the hill, dozens of objects of different shapes and sizes sticking out of the ground, the parts in metal reflecting the rays of the afternoon sun. What are those things I see spread all over that hillside?
It's just junk, Filippo said, shaking his head, shoving his hands in his pockets.
You mean like a junkyard? In the middle of the vineyard?
People make a big deal about it, Filippo said. They call it art, but those are all pieces of used plastic and metal that some old guy collects and makes into shapes. Like I said, junk.
They look like animal shapes. I think I see human figures, too.
It looks like some have wings, too, like angels.
Between now and December, you'll see even more pop up. It's supposed to look like a giant nativity scene by Christmas. People go crazy over it.
Oh, yeah, I remember reading about that, Jolene said, wondering why Filippo sounded so critical, especially if the project attracted off-season visitors. What's the story behind it?
Another time, Jolene. We just got here, and although you don't want to admit it, I know you're exhausted. I want you to rest up and freshen up now, and I'll go do the same. I'll stop by for you at 5, all right?
All right, she said, as Filippo kissed the top of her head and walked to the door.
Be ready at 5, he called over his shoulder.
I will, she replied, but Filippo was already on the other side. Now that the options for how to spend her first afternoon in Manarola had been drastically reduced, the idea of stretching out on the bed after a long, hot shower held a certain allure. But first, she needed more of that window. Leaning out as far as she could, she tilted her face to the slanted sun rays, letting the wind tousle her hair while her lungs drank in the fresh breeze. Though she saw only a corner of the sea, she could hear its waves crashing against the rocks below and was thrilled at the thought of falling asleep to that sound every night. Inhaling through her nose, she held her breath as long as she could before slowly releasing it, imagining the invigorating sea air cleansing her body of the stale, artificial airplane air. After taking several breaths, she left the window and went to the bathroom, stripped off her clothes, and let them drop to the tile floor, suddenly feeling too stiff and tired to even consider picking them up. The plastic door to the shower stall shuddered with resistance when she tried to slide it open, but she managed to reach inside and turn on the water. When it became apparent that the spray wouldn't grow any stronger or hotter, she turned sideways to squeeze into the stall, flinching at the tepid trickle of water while wondering whether guests were required to specify their height and weight before being assigned this room. This sweet, sweet 16. Smiling to herself, she tilted her head back, delighting in the feel of the fresh water falling on her face and neck, trickling down her back and tummy, buttocks and thighs, dripping over her swollen feet. It was sweet and soft like the last summer rain. Jolene couldn't remember lying down on her bed or drifting off to sleep, but she would never forget gasping for air that first afternoon when she jolted awake to find a man's thumbs propping open her eyelids. Seconds earlier, she'd been dreaming of a horrific accident. In the dream, she was lying on the ground unconscious while a man knelt beside her, checking her vital signs. But the thumbs holding her eyes open now weren't a doctor's, they were Filippo's, and this was his perverse way of rousing her when she failed to wake up.
Ciao, splendore, he chuckled, amused, as always, at her reaction.
Please don't do that, she cried, her heart pounding. She felt crabby and disoriented, and it wasn't until she spotted the photographs of the dead fish that she remembered where she was.
It's 5, Filippo said.
As if on cue, the church bells tolled, their doleful sound reverberating in the still room. Jolene wished she hadn't fallen asleep. Besides being a waste of time, naps always gave her a headache.
These are for you, Filippo said, setting a bunch of flowers on her abdomen. Now she really felt like an accident victim, one who hadn't survived.
Staring at the bouquet of white chrysanthemums wrapped in cellophane and tied with a bow, she pulled herself up in bed, then stretched and crossed her legs to make sure all limbs were still intact.
I wanted to bring you roses, but it's next to impossible to find decent flowers in this place, Filippo added.
You didn't need to do that, Jolene said, her jaw tight as she fought off a yawn. It would be rude to yawn in the face of a man who brought flowers. The fact was, Filippo had showered her with hundreds of roses since the day they'd met on the boat last June. He'd brought them to her personally, he'd had them delivered to her at work, He'd hidden them in her apartment. He'd left them on the windshield of her car. Jolene had enjoyed the attention more than the bouquets, never having the heart to tell him that cut flowers, especially roses, depressed her.
They only had these on account of tomorrow being Sunday, he said.
They're lovely, really.
You don't like them, do you? I can't blame you. People only buy chrysanthemums for the dead here.
Of course I like them, Filippo. They're gorgeous, Jolene said, running her fingers through her hair. It was still damp from her shower and plastered to the back of her head. Clammy and chilled, she shuddered with another yawn, this one too powerful to stifle.
You don't look too impressed, Filippo said. You know my greatest joy is to make you feel special.
And you do, Filippo, she said. I'm just groggy. How about you? Did you take a nap?
Are you kidding? Mamma kept telling me to go lie down, but every time I tried to leave, she suddenly had one more question to ask me about you-know-who.
About me? Jolene asked, tucking the sheet tight under her knees as if sealing herself inside a pie crust.
What do you think?
It's only natural, I suppose, Jolene said, averting her eyes. The thought of being a topic of conversation made her uncomfortable.
What did you say? I hope you were kind.
What do you think? He asked again, placing a finger under her chin and tilting her head so that she was forced to face him.
Well, I think, yes, you were kind.
She'd never known Filippo to be unkind, except when he did that eyelid thing to her.
You think or you know? He asked.
He was testing her now, playing one of those little trust-building games he'd used to bolster her confidence in him at the beginning, like when he made her stand there, close her eyes, and lean back until she fell into his arms. It had been easy to fall in love with Filippo, but her trust had been broken too often by too many people before him for it to follow automatically. The fact that she'd taken the plane and come to Italy with him should suffice as proof that she'd overcome her wariness.
Look at me, Jolene.
Filippo's eyes were so dark in the dim light that she couldn't distinguish the pupils from the irises.
Do you think, or do you know, that I would only speak highly of you to my mother?
I know, she said. I know. Though she still wondered exactly what he'd said to Luisa, she was still too out of it to pursue the discussion.
What I don't know is how you can look so rested.
Who needs rest? I'm as excited as a little boy at Christmas, being back here now, with you on my arm and my certificate from Cornell in my pocket, makes me feel like Santa just delivered a wagon load of gifts, all with my name tag on them.
He tugged at the sheet Jolene was wrapped in, his eyes now bright with mischief. Any chance I could sneak a peek at one of those presents?
Jolene laughed, pinning the sheet down with her hands. Christmas is still a couple of months away, little boy, she said. But when he kissed her on the mouth, she fell back on the bed and threw the sheet aside, locking her arms behind her head and smiling an invitation.
Glancing at his watch, Filippo sighed. It's almost 5:30. Mamma will be waiting.
Give me 3 minutes, Jolene cried. Jumping out of bed, she threw open her suitcase and rummaged through her clothes, searching for an outfit sturdy enough to bear the memories of her first evening in Manarola.
3. Café? Luisa asked from behind the bar, her hand already gripping the permanently extended arm of the cimbali.
No more for me, mamma, Filippo said. I must have had 5 since we got here. But I'm sure Jolene could use a pick-me-up after her nap.
Yes, thank you, that would be wonderful, Jolene said, thinking that a jolt of caffeine might alleviate her headache. What she really craved was a hot, frothy cappuccino, but she hesitated to ask. Her mother had taught her to accept what she was offered.
Come on, speak up. I know you're dying for a cappuccino, Filippo said, poking her in the ribs.
You're right, I am, Jolene said, smiling.
Filippo was always so thoughtful that way, anticipating her every desire as if they'd known each other for years. Whenever they went to the Starbucks in Ithaca, before she could ask for anything, he ordered her cappuccino exactly the way she liked it. A double dose of strong coffee with piping hot whole milk, topped off with a generous sprinkle of cinnamon. Luisa moved more swiftly than any barista she'd ever seen. And though the racket she made by banging the filter to empty it, then grinding fresh coffee to refill it, pained Jolene's throbbing temples, she was fascinated by her sure-handed efficiency, undoubtedly achieved through years of repeating the same gestures over and over again. As Jolene watched her tamp the coffee, secure the filter in place, then hit the brew button in one seamless motion, she wondered whether the woman planned to continue working after the renovations or was looking forward to retirement.
"So what will it be?"
Luisa asked, holding a cappuccino cup in one hand and an espresso cup in the other.
"Espresso, of course," Filippo replied to his mother, who placed the small cup under the filter just in time to catch the first thick black drop of coffee. "You're in Italy now, cara Jo," he said, turning to Jolene. "You don't want to be caught drinking cappuccino when it's almost dinner time, like some common tourist. Cappuccinos are for breakfast, for dunking brioches."
Jolene opened her mouth to say that she wouldn't have asked for a cappuccino if he hadn't suggested it, but instead of speaking, she blushed. She was glad that Luisa was turned the other way, wiping down the shiny metal surfaces of the cimbali while waiting for the last of the coffee to drizzle into the cup, and couldn't see her pink cheeks.
"Thank you very much," Jolene said when Luisa set the little white cup in front of her.
It wasn't that she didn't like espresso, there just wasn't much of it. She'd have to sip it slowly if she wanted it to last.
"I'm starving," Filippo said. "Our last meal, if you can call it that, was on the plane."
Luisa, busy drying glasses, didn't comment. Jolene, her nose deep inside the tiny cup, was concentrating on the heady aroma of the brew, hoping it would clear her head.
"Where's Babbo, anyway?"
Filippo asked, drumming his fingers on the bar. "He hasn't even shown his face yet."
"He was here earlier to get things started for tonight, but he had something or other to repair on his boat, as usual."
"And how about Lorenzo?"
"Your brother called to say he got held up with a problem in Genoa."
"Imagine that. Not that it bothers me personally, but how does he expect you to manage without him on a Saturday night?"
Judging from what Filippo had told her, Lorenzo didn't help with the family-run operation at all. She must have misunderstood. Again. She reminded herself that now was not the time to ask questions, so unless someone spoke to her directly, she would linger over her demitasse in silence, listening and learning.
"Your father and I will do just fine, like in the old days," Luisa said. "In the old days, you were younger than I am now, and very few people knew this place even existed." "We can handle it, Filippo. We'll relax tomorrow. Business is finally slowing down on Sunday nights, so I've told your father I want to close the doors to the public so we can all have dinner together and celebrate. After all, it's not every day your son comes home from New York with a girlfriend no one even heard of until 2 weeks ago."
Jolene's jaw dropped, together with the cup she'd already drained. Filippo had asked her to marry him almost 2 months ago. Why had he kept it from his family until 2 weeks ago? And why did she refer to Jolene as his girlfriend and not his fiancée? Jolene presumed that the distinction was as significant in Italian as it was in English. Fortunately, confusion did not hamper her reflexes, and she caught the cup an instant before it could roll off the bar and crash to the floor.
"Tomorrow evening is perfect," Filippo said, shooting a glance at Jolene. "Hopefully Jolene will be more rested by then. Right, Splendore?"
"Right," Jolene said, setting the cup on its saucer and pushing it away.
"Hey, allora," a man's voice boomed from the doorway.
"Babbo,"
Filippo cried, jumping in front of the man before Jolene could catch a glimpse of his face. All she could see of him were the two muscular forearms encircling Filippo's torso and the two hands thumping his back with that awkward sort of roughness men sometimes display when they fear succumbing to emotion. The red hands and particles of dirt under the ragged nails of his stubby fingers told her he was still the working man of Jabata's anecdotes and not the distinguished hotelier of Jolene's imagination. Her chest tightened with envy as she witnessed the paternal embrace, and she had to look away. Glancing at Luisa, she noted her expression of placid benevolence as she regarded the reunion from behind the bar, where she continued drying glasses with the striped linen dish towel that seemed to be attached to her hand. Standing among three Garaventis, Jolene was struck by how ill-equipped she was to fit into this family of strangers. Like an understudy called in to play a role she had long coveted but never rehearsed for. Her eyes darted around the room, searching for cues, clues, direction, a back exit. The neon-lit bar area where they stood was rather small, stuffy rather than cozy, permeated with the odors of strong coffee and house wine and sweat and fish and brine. Of lingering cigarette smoke and idle talk, of the dampness that penetrated the thick stone walls and made newspapers stick to the varnished tabletops. She perceived the presence of more males than females, of more locals than tourists, and when her eyes wandered through an arched passage leading to another, larger room, she glimpsed empty tables draped in cloths, crouching ghost-like as if poised to frighten off the next invasion of diners. Filippo was right. She could already tell that there was great potential to make the Locanda more alluring to foreigners. But she wouldn't want to alienate the locals. She wouldn't want to forsake the characteristic.
"Where's the girl?"
the man called out, cutting short Jolene's musings. Turning to face him, Jolene saw that his eyes were dark and saucer-shaped, like Filippo's. But while Filippo's were often glazed over with the hypnotic veneer that comes from staring at a computer screen for too long, his father's eyes brimmed with a natural brightness as if they had soaked up an enormous amount of light from the sky and the sea. They twinkled in a different way, too. Unlike the fleeting flashes of intensity that brightened Filippo's eyes when he got wind of a rare opportunity or devised a clever scheme, his father's eyes sparkled as though he were anticipating a forbidden pleasure or had recently committed some mischief. He squinted at her as he approached, as if he were focusing on a faraway horizon. Before she could decide how to address him, he gathered her in his thick arms and squeezed her tight, his barrel chest pressing against her thumping heart.
"Sono Vittorio,"
he said, after stepping back a pace and placing an open hand on his chest, the friendly native greeting the foreigner. His voice was gravelly and determined, its cadence rhythmic, like waves raking pebbles on the beach.
"Capisci l'italiano, no?"
"Ci provo," Jolene said, disappointed that the hug was already over. "I try my best."
"Good for you. People who don't want to try should stay home, where they can act like they know what they're talking about, and other people can act like they understand them,"
Vittorio said.
"Did you have a good trip?"
"Yes, but it was long, and after we changed planes in Rome, we—"
"Planes? I don't even want to hear about them,"
Vittorio said, rolling his eyes the same way Filippo did.
"Me neither," Jolene said. "I hate planes."
"Good, we agree,"
Vittorio said with a clap of his hands.
"So let's eat. We'll have time to talk later."
"Everything's practically ready," Luisa said, wiping her hands on her apron. "I'll finish setting up while the spaghetti is cooking."
"Can I do anything to help?" Jolene asked.
"You've already done enough," Luisa said. "You got our son to come back." "Offer Giuseppina a glass of wine,"
Vittorio ordered.
"It's Jolene," Filippo said,
but his father had already disappeared down the corridor, which must lead to the kitchen. Jolene was curious to see the setup and would have liked to tag along, but having just met the man, she thought it best to wait for an invitation. Vittorio whistled as he went, turning on more neon lights along the way. Jolene detested neon lights, and so did Filippo. Eliminating them was one thing they'd already agreed on.
"Are you switching to wine, then?"
Filippo asked, taking two glasses from a shelf. After holding them up to check for water spots, he placed them on the bar, nudging one, then the other, until they were perfectly lined up. Yes, please, Jolene said. The coffee hadn't done much to clear her head. She might as well aim for total befuddlement. Funny, isn't it?
What?
Filippo asked, selecting a bottle from the refrigerated display case. When we met, I was the one serving you the wine, she said.
Yes, and I got knocked out on the spot, Filippo said,
turning to look her in the eye.
By the waitress, not by the wine. You looked so sharp in your jacket and bow tie, so professional.
His comment made Jolene wince. She'd never been afraid of hard work, but it hadn't been easy to start.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.